I'm Elex Michaelson. This week, the issue is the California recall debate. We helped to moderate the first televised debate between some of the governor's top challengers. We're also in the spin room, one-on-one with all the candidates for behind-the-scenes interviews, plus insights and analysis on where we go from here with some of California's top reporters, Politico's Carla Marinucci and Seema Mehta of the LA Times. A very special edition of The Issue Is starts right now.
Broadcasting across California, California's only statewide political show. You're watching The Issue Is.
I'm Elex Michaelson. This week, The Issue Is, Fox 11 Los Angeles, KTVU in the Bay Area, the Nixon Library, teamed up to host the first televised debate, also airing on Salem Radio. It's been talked about by almost every major media outlet across the state and the country. Fox 11 Los Angeles colleague Christine Devine and myself co-moderated the debate. It happened at the Nixon Library along with Hugh Hewitt of Salem Radio. He was also asking questions, and the former National Security Advisor, Robert O'Brien. The candidates on stage, businessman John Cox, former San Diego Mayor Kevin Faulconer, Assemblyman Kevin Kiley, and former Congressman Doug Ose. Larry Elder, Caitlin Jenner, and Governor Newsom declined our invitations to attend. The event airing live for 90 minutes commercial-free. Here are some of the most memorable moments, starting with a discussion about COVID mandates.
Where do you stand on a mask in schools? And would you allow for local control for districts who have their own numbers that they're concerned about to deal with this themselves?
Well, first and foremost, I urge everyone to get vaccinated. Vaccinations is how we get our way out of this. But I do not favor mandates. I favor educate. You're not going to mandate your way out of the coronavirus.
Would you ban a mask mandate in schools?
I do not support a mask mandate in schools. It's about
education.
Mayor,
I got to press you on this, though. Will you use your authority to bar mask mandates, not oppose them, but to forbid them?
That's absolutely something I would look into doing here, 100%.
Look into doing or do?
I don't think we should do mandates. I think the governor's COVID management was an absolute disaster. It resulted in far more danger and far more problems. He got slapped down in court, too, for closing the churches. Strip clubs and pot shops were deemed essential.
Our legislature and our governor right now have said, you will do this without giving people options. I'm for giving people options. Take your kid to a different school, shop somewhere else. I'm not in favor of a government overreach as defined by the CDC.
Congressman Ose, on our statewide political show, The Issue Is, last week, you referred to Mayor Faulconer as a plastic man and said that his plan when it comes to homelessness is disingenuous. Mayor, we'll give you the opportunity to respond in a moment, but first to you, Congressman, what do you mean by plastic man, and what specifically would you do differently when it comes to homelessness?
So the facts of what's happened in San Diego is that in 2017, the administration there changed the methodology by which they counted homeless and excluded people living in their cars or their RVs. Number went down. The city police department has been engaged in rousting homeless, the net result of which is that people have been moved out of San Diego into the satellite cities around San Diego, reducing numbers in San Diego, but not reducing overall numbers. These are not answers. Hotels for homeless, not an answer. All it does is take somebody who's dying on the street and put them in a hotel room where they can die. You cannot advocate hotels for homeless without also mandatorily requiring treatment.
Yeah, I think it's important to get to the facts, Alex, on particularly this issue, which is so incredibly important. The fact that it was proud in San Diego that we reduced homelessness by double digits, the only city, big city in California to do that. And yes, with the same methodology that every other city was using. And in fact, not only did it go down in San Diego, it went down in the county as well. Why? Because I took aggressive, firm action. I did not allow tent encampments on the streets when I was mayor of San Diego.
If we have to, we're going to force people to get into treatment. We're not just going to buy hotels. The city attorney in San Diego just sued, by the way, to avoid a couple of hotel deals where excessive prices were paid for hotels in San Diego. We have got to stop wasting money on this. We've got to do the smart thing, and that is get people in treatment, get conservatorships if we need to. Britney Spears didn't need a conservator. A lot of the people living on the streets do.
The governor's own mental health czar, his top mental health advisor, said in an interview in March that homelessness in California is not a money problem, it's a leadership problem. So what would I do? I would bring a new strategy and I would bring new leadership.
Bruce Awashi asks, how do you clean up the EDD mess, perhaps $30 billion in fraudulent unemployment claims in these COVID times? Others say it takes them days to get on the phone to get help to get their checks. How do you correct things?
Let's figure out, by going and looking at other entities that have large employee pools or large sales volumes, how do they prevent fraud? And let's incorporate those measures into the EDD process. And secondarily, just answer the damn phone, all right? Just answer the damn phone.
That's a soundbite right there.
If Senator Feinstein were to retire next year, you would be in charge of appointing her replacement. If you picked a Republican, the Republicans would get control of the United States Senate. There are a lot of Democrats who would say, she's a Democrat, Senator Padilla is a Democrat. They both won overwhelmingly. Joe Biden won this state by 30 points. She should be replaced by a Democrat. Isn't that the most fair thing? And can you commit that you would appoint a Democrat to that seat?
Well, actually, Alex, I hate to do this, but I have to reject the premise of your question. I wouldn't make an appointment at all. I would leave it up to the voters, which is exactly what I, asked Gavin Newsom to do when there was the vacancy in Kamala Harris's seat. He didn't do so. He appointed Alex Padilla, who had a very fraught history in his tenure as Secretary of State. And so the voters of California were deprived of choosing their state senator, one of the most important offices in the entire country.
All right, very interesting. Mayor Faulconer, the Newsom campaign has repeatedly called this a Republican recall driven by Trump supporters. They fought to even get that language on the ballot.
They did.
I'm wondering, for you, we know that you supported President Trump in 2016 and 2020. After January 6, are you still a Trump supporter? Do you welcome his endorsement? And would you want him to come campaign for you?
Well, look, first and foremost, what happened on January 6 was abhorrent to our country. To have folks storm our Capitol, to attack our Capitol police officers, that was wrong in every way imaginable. We want to have those folks held accountable, and I think that's incredibly important. And I will tell you, Alex, when it comes, I think you hit the nail on the head, by the way. What Gavin Newsom wants to do is make this all about Republican or Donald Trump. What he doesn't want people to do is talk about his failed record and what's not happening here in California.
So are you a Trump supporter, though? You're saying he's afraid of the far left. Are you afraid of the far right?
I'm not afraid of anybody. Not afraid of anybody.
So what's the answer?
I'm going to proudly take the endorsement and support of any Republican, independent, or Democrat who wants to get rid of Gavin Newsom and make California a better state.
Mr. Cox, Larry Elder is not here tonight. We invited him. He had a fundraiser and chose not to come. But he has said that he wants the minimum wage to be zero in this state, that the minimum wage should be zero. Do you agree with that? And do you support the current minimum wage of $15 an hour?
Well, I like Larry. I was on his show a lot in 2018. He said I would be a great governor, for the record. I think there's a place for a minimum wage, but I think he's right from the standpoint that I think the free market is a much better judge of what wages should be.
So what should the minimum wage be?
You know, that's a question. Right now, it's, what, $12 an hour?
Going up to 15.
I think it should be gauged versus other states, but I'd like to see the real true minimum wage. I agree with Larry. It should be zero. It should be set between the employer and the employee.
As governor, you have the power to reverse the Governor Newsom's first-in-the-nation move to expand Medi-Cal to undocumented immigrants that are elderly. Would you do so?
Yeah, that's the wrong approach that the governor took, 100%. We're a very welcoming state. We take care of people. We provide emergency services. But as we continue to layer on cost after cost, you are taking what was meant to be insurance programs and turning them into welfare programs. That's unsustainable.
Assemblyman, you are an attorney. As governor, you would have the ability to appoint judges, which are so important to policy in this state. What is your judicial philosophy, and what does a judge look like that you're appointing?
Well, I appoint judges that would uphold the Constitution and would set the parameters for our politics, that would not seek to, participate in our politics.
Congressman Ose, as governor, you have the power to declare states of emergency. Are there any states of emergency that you would declare in that job?
I think the governor's power in this aspect needs to be constrained. I would go to the legislature and voluntarily ask them to put a time limit on the duration of whatever management, whatever emergency period I might otherwise need to declare prospectively. That's the problem we're dealing with right now, is that there's no time limit on the current California Emergency Management Act that the governor is exercising all of this authority from.
You can stream the full debate commercial-free right now at foxla.com, youtube.com/Elex Michaelson, or if you prefer to listen as a podcast, just search for The Issue Is wherever you stream your podcast. Coming up next, we take you inside the spin room for interviews with all the candidates, and we ask Kevin Kiley, how does he talk so fast? Plus, analysis from two of California's top reporters, both attended the debate, Seema Mehta of the LA Times, Carla Marinucci of Politico. Next.
California had the slowest rollout of any state. For a time, we were 50th out of 50 in actually administering our doses. I had asked Newsom to call a special session of the legislature so we could be there to help, but he refused. He said he was going to do it on his own, and he blew it.
I wasn't the only one who noticed that Assemblyman Kevin Kiley has a supernatural ability to talk really, really, really fast. It was one of the topics we discussed after the debate in the spin room.
How do you talk so fast?
I was amazed by your speed.
You know, I have a lot to say, and I hope that, none of it got lost. But look, I think that that sort of is of a piece with what I'm saying about the short time frame we have here in this after this election. There is going to be 1 year. There is going to be no time to waste. And so, I'm going to be acting just as governor just as quickly as I was talking in that debate.
What'd you think? What was your big takeaway?
I felt great about tonight. It was a real opportunity for me to introduce myself to more Californians about the job I did as mayor of San Diego, the turnaround that we did in San Diego.
Well, I was pleased to be here. You were very kind to invite me.
Thank you.
I was able to get, I think, a good sense of who I am out to the voters. I will tell you, you call me, I'm going to answer the damn phone.
Of course, a reference to what you said about the EDD. How do you shake up this race, and where do you see the state of this race right now?
Well, I'm the guy that's different, frankly. The other guys are politicians, and then we have the media guy who wasn't here.
If you had to boil it down, real bottom line, what is your most important message to California voters?
My message is that our government is broken, and that this recall is a chance to fix it.
Your most important message to voters, it would be what?
We need a business guy to fix the problems of this state.
I'm going to make California more affordable and more livable.
I get stuff done. The bottom line is, can you get stuff done?
Both of our panelists this week get good journalism done every week. They were in that spin room with us earlier this week. They're now joining us via Zoom. Carla Marinucci writes the California Playbook every weekday for Politico. And Seema Mehta writes for the Los Angeles Times. Welcome back to both of you. Two of our favorites here on The Issue Is. Carla, you were in the spin room. You watched all this. Your big takeaway from the debate.
I mean, look, they accomplished job one. They had to introduce themselves, all four, to California voters, particularly to Republicans, to fire up those Republican voters, to get them to sign that ballot when it comes in. And they're going out now. They also did the other thing that was really important, bash Gavin Newsom for 90 minutes on everything from COVID to crime to homelessness. They needed to make the case against him. They certainly tried to do that.
This is the biggest stage that they've been on during this recall election. And I think they each tried to make their case in different ways. They largely agreed on policy, so we didn't see a lot of differentiation there. But they argued, I think, that they're each of them sort of in their own way argued that their experience, whether as a businessman, whether as a legislator, that's what made them the most qualified and the most capable of competing with Gavin Newsom and governing the state.
So part of the challenge, though, is breaking through, especially running against a guy like Larry Elder, who's been on the radio for 30 years, has more name ID than any of those guys on the stage, chose not to come to the debate. Carla, what do you make of Larry Elder's place in this race right now? It seems like the Newsom campaign is trying to make it a Larry Elder versus Gavin Newsom race.
Yeah, and in many ways, Alex, Larry Elder has been a gift to the Gavin Newsom campaign. It's been a way that he's been able to focus on one person, a talk show host, a conservative talk show host, who said some very controversial things in years in public life. They're going to tie him to Rush Limbaugh, Sean Hannity, Tucker Carlson, Bill O'Reilly, those shows that he's been on many times and made statements like reducing the minimum wage to nothing, getting rid of maternity leave, et cetera. They're already taking that and using it as ammunition against him.
But is there some danger in that, Seema? And this makes me think about when so many Democrats were salivating to run against Donald Trump. Larry Elder gets people on the right fired up. This is an election where a lot of people want to give the middle finger to Sacramento, and Larry Elder represents the middle finger better than any of those guys on the stage.
I do think that it's been clear since he entered the race, which was only a couple weeks ago, we've seen he's totally fired up Republican voters as well as donors. I mean, he's raised an enormous amount of money in a very short amount of time. This election is very unusual because, as we know, it's a recall election, but it's also, you know, every Californian is going to get mailed a ballot. The enthusiasm is on the Republican side. You know, we don't know exactly yet how Democrats are going to increase the enthusiasm on their side. So there's a lot of unpredictability in terms of who's going to cast ballots. And Larry Elder has certainly captured the eye of Republican voters since he entered the race.
Up next, we talk about the governor's response to our debate and his strategy going forward. We're getting a look at that. Includes a lot of cleaning up with trash bags. More with Carla and Seema when we come back. You're watching The Issue Is.
1 million dollars to his choice of charity in exchange for a 2-hour discussion live, and that is coming from my own personal money, not campaign money.
So why YouTube star and Democratic candidate Kevin Paffrath with the challenge for Governor Newsom this week. The governor hasn't responded to that, but he did clearly watch our debate. Here's his response to that.
Listen to those guys, that's a COVID cliff. They want to set us back, not move us forward.
Back with our panel, Seema Mehta of the LA Times and Carla Marinucci of Politico. Seema, let's start with you. Where does the governor go from here?
I just think we're going to see a much more active sort of campaign stance. And also, I mean, he's already starting to draw a contrast with Larry Elder, which is notable because he hasn't really drawn a contrast one-on-one with any of the other candidates who are hoping to replace them.
I mean, Carla, is that sort of an acknowledgement that maybe the strategy so far hasn't totally worked?
Yeah, I mean, in some ways it hasn't, because Newsom has had to battle two things, a complacency and indifference among Democrats. A lot of them saying, this is recall. It's never going to get through. They're going to avoid those ballots altogether. At this point, he has to fire up those voters. It's all about persuasion. That's over. It's now about turnout. He's got to get those people to sign the ballots.
What makes both of you two of the best reporters in our state is you're both really good at gossiping with people behind the scenes to get a sense of what's really going on beyond the talking points. So, Seema, let's start with you. Are the Democrats starting to get nervous when it comes to the recall? Have you noticed a change in the last few weeks?
I feel like, you know, 6 months ago, there was just this feeling like everything's fine. You know, COVID's going to go away. Schools will be reopening. You know, this is going to be a piece of cake. And I mean, a lot has changed. First of all, with the pandemic is so unpredictable. We have this new variant. You know, people are being advised to wear masks again indoors. So we had, you know, people are talking about, you know, are school children going to have to wear masks when they go back to school? But in the polling, we're certainly seeing the enthusiasm gap. Republicans are fired up to vote and Democrats are not fired up to vote. And if they don't vote, I mean, it could be really close. I mean, so there's a lot of uncertainty. And I think there's also a question, you know, Newsom and his allies made a decision to not have a prominent Democrat as sort of an insurance policy on that second question, the replacement candidate. And now I think there is some concern about, you know, was that the right strategy?
And Carla, in terms of what you're hearing behind the scenes, have you noticed, are people starting to get a little more nervous?
Yeah, they're starting to say maybe it's time to bring out the really big guns, Kamala Harris, Joe Biden. Look, a lot's at stake for the Democrats here when you consider what's going on the other coast. Andrew Cuomo, another big blue state governor, in real trouble. Democrats can't afford to have that kind of situation as they're heading into 2022. Right now, the governor needs to pivot, a lot of them are saying, and get out there with real people and make a really aggressive case, not fly so much above the fray, but get down and get dirty to fight this recall.
Well, Carla, Seema, great seeing both of you in person this week at our debate. Thank you for coming and for covering it. And thank you for being a source of so much wisdom for all of us each and every day. Great to see you.
Thank you.
When we come back, personal issues from The Issue Is at the center of the California recall debate. Why did John Cox's nose hairs start trending on Twitter? That's when we come back. Our debate with Governor Newsom's challengers ended the way so many of our big interviews here on The Issue is, and with a game of personal issues, our rapid fire and often revealing game.
So, Mr. Cox, what is something embarrassing your kids would tell us about you?
Oh, boy, that my wife doesn't like my nose hair.
Okay.
Oh, too much information.
Mayor Faulconer, when you're not working, what are you doing for fun?
I love to cycle when I have the time, and I've been a big supporter of the Challenged Athletes Foundation. A shout out to everybody who's watching. They're training for their big ride from San Francisco to San Diego, raising funds for Challenged Athletes. I love to get out on the bike.
Ambassador Kiley, what's your favorite restaurant in California?
Did I get promoted?
Oh, sorry. I'm sorry. Assembly, right. Kiley. Who knows?
Maybe one day. Maybe one day.
I would go with Frank Fats. It's close to the Capitol, but there's actually two offshoots of it in my district. Unbelievably good Chinese food.
You didn't say French Laundry.
Congressman, apparently I'm one of the few politicians in California who hasn't.
Congressman Ose, do you have any hidden talents?
It's the same talent I wear on my sleeve. I get things done.
Okay. Very nice.
Didn't realize that was a hidden talent. But speaking of getting things done, there is a Twitter account called GIF Caucus. I have no idea who's behind it, but that person makes GIFs of big moments in California politics, and they're often from our show. So we leave this week with their work from this week. That's John Cox. My wife doesn't like my nose hair. One reminder, you can stream our full debate in its entirety right now, or listen to it in podcast form. Just search for The Issue Is. We'll see you next week. Thanks for watching.